Hello again, everyone, and your favourite podcast, Pull the Pin, is back. And today we are pulling the pin on diversity, literally. Pull the Pin is all about business, brand, and banter. These guys have got plenty of all three. They've got some moves, nothing compared to mine, which we are going to see later. But they became famous for winning the third ever Britain's Got Talent. It's all gone downhill since then. One's got the looks, the other's got the talent. You decide which is which. It's only Ashley and Jordan from Diversity.
Cool, we've been sitting in silence now. I want to go.
Let's go.
Now, we've got you, so you can't
escape.
Oh, we were joking earlier. So when we said we got the winners of Britain's Got Talent, and everyone's like, great, I've always wanted to meet Paul Potts. It's not Paul Potts,
like, unfortunately.
Susan Boyle, she never won. Exactly. That was Ashley earlier. She didn't win.
No, didn't win Britain's Got Talent.
We eventually got round to diversity. But no, guys, seriously, thanks so much for doing this, because it's been really, really difficult to line up. To be honest, I thought you were just dodging me.
Never dodging you.
They've been blowing me off for like 8 months. Not literally. Well. That sounded really bad. Just to clarify, I have not been blown off by diversity. I mean the entire group. Jordan, yes, but not the whole group. Guys, you're very welcome to come in at this point and introduce yourselves.
Yeah,
I'll just keep talking.
I think you've done it all, but I'm Ash.
Jordan, hey gang.
We are Ashley and Jordan Banjo.
Yeah.
You said that already, didn't we?
Why are you acting like we're a new act on the X Factor? I'm Ashley, I'm Jordan, and together we're Ashley and Jordan.
I'm in BGT mode, I'm ready for it. But no, like you said, Al, we're here. Happy to be here, mate. Genuinely looking forward to having fun for the next hour or so.
Next 8 hours.
But we were
chatting earlier actually about the fact that we started Grenade. Actually, we started the idea in 2009,
yep.
And it was around that same time, obviously, you won BGT. And I was going to go into a nice spiel about the fact that you kind of inspired me to go and do something, which would be a lie.
Fair enough. Honesty is key.
That's not true. So you didn't inspire me. I was already doing it.
Yep.
But no, I always remember you guys winning that, because it was kind of, you remember the things that were happening around the time and stuff as well. So, and I'll tell you what, couldn't be happier for you guys. Not only to actually win that 11 years ago now, but also the fact you're still going strong, doing it, you're still popular as ever. You've obviously just got this passion for it, that you just love it, and it just shines in person, all over social media. And you came across as such decent, honest, nice guys then. Obviously, I know that's bollocks now, having met you.
Do you know what? I was just about to say, that's the nicest consecutive round of things that you've ever said to us.
I know, I'm really sorry. I feel like I have to take it away.
Yeah, yeah.
I giveth. I'm like God in that sense. I giveth and taketh away. I'm gonna diversify now. I was in the Apple shop the other week, and 3 hours late for the appointment because they were running over. And I said, I've got an appointment here, so why is it taking so long? And they said, this is the Apple shop in Solihull. They said, well, we're like the NHS, so you have to kind of wait your turn. I was like, not really, you're sort of working in a shop, you're not saving lives. You are nothing like the NHS.
Yeah.
So it was just reminded me of the I Am God comment.
I love how we're 5 minutes in to the podcast and hours compared himself to God.
Yeah, but bigged you up as well. Big you up. I've never seen anyone with such big feet as you do. Literally. We have had to move cars outside so they can put the trainers by the front door. It's absolutely ridiculous. But no, so being serious now, so where did all this start for you guys, dancing, and what was the run up to, like, I know it was a long time ago now, but the run up to Britain's Got Talent, whose idea was it? Mm. Obviously, it's changed your lives monumentally since you've done it. Tell us some stuff we don't know.
Go for it.
Do you want me to head into the story?
You crack on,
son. I'll crack on.
Jordan's burnt out with it already.
He's had enough.
Fuck it, you tell it.
I'm just waiting to laugh.
So my dad was a boxer, pro boxer, and he had a boxing gym, and he turned his gym into a dance studio for my mum. Come on hard times, it was like, right, how do we kind of get some money? How do we kind of turn the business around? So my mum opened a dance school in my dad's old boxing gym. Fast forward 10 years, we're now there. There's a few boys there, and like, dancing wasn't really cool for boys, like, way back when. It was more like something
still
that
isn't.
Girls did.
It is, I'm joking.
We're going to move past that. But yeah, we were
I'm trying to get into the emotional part of this story.
We are taking it seriously.
Yeah, we are.
Some more than others.
But essentially, we had a big group of boys. It was more like a social club.
That sounds wrong.
No, there's nothing wrong with that, Al.
Sorry, go on. We'll edit that out.
It was just like a place that we all used to go and everyone used to chill out. And there was a lot of, even now, there's a lot of boys in diversity who would have either been, I'm pretty sure, like either in prison or dead if it wasn't for the group, because they're just in an area that wasn't good.
So it kind of became a place
for us to all get together, all do something positive. And then at one point we were like, oh, we're actually all right. We're not actually bad at this. And then we entered a competition, we won it. And then literally 2 years after our first competition, we were dancing somewhere and a scout came from Britain's Got Talent, walking through with her shopping and was like, have you ever heard of this show? We were like, oh, of course we have. She was like, would you enter? And we were like, no, no way. I said, I'm not going on TV to have somebody tell me, especially not with him. He was really bad back in the day as well.
I was really reluctant to it.
Like, I didn't want to go on TV and have somebody tell us that like we wasn't good enough, because I just love what we did.
Yeah.
And it took a couple of years of them asking and we finally went on and kind of like the rest is history. But I think that's part of the success for us. Like, not only did we not go on the show looking for fame, we didn't even really go on the show looking to win. We just kind of went on the show looking to have the experience and be the best we could. And then that's what we do now in the best possible way. And I don't mean this rudely, like we almost like don't care. We love what we do. We got a skill that we've worked hard for and we kind of work to like keep our bubble together and keep being able to do what we do and entertain people. But we're not like chasing, you know, like the idea of like fame or chasing anything else. We just, being. Do you know what I mean?
Do you know as well? And that shows, and you know, we talk about business and stuff obviously a lot on the show, and these are the best businesses. So sorry to kind of talk about diversity as a business, but again, it's a brand. Let's say it's a brand.
These are the best brands.
Mm. The sense that you just got passionate people that love what they do. And then it kind of organically morphs into what it is. I know you've had to work incredibly hard, but you haven't had to really try to sort of steer this in something that it can't be or doesn't need to be, because you don't need to.
It happens. And that, it's interesting that you said that. Like, you know, you said like,
I'm a very interesting person.
Sometimes talking about like diversity as a brand almost feels funny. But even though like we sit down and we'll have conversations about strategy, and obviously you don't grow sort of like to this level without having those conversations and doing it properly. But at the same time, it never feels like that, because at the heart of it, it's just real. It's our life.
Yeah.
You know, being able to monetize it and make it work and being able to put food on the table is obviously important, but what's more important is the fact that it's real, and we've done, we do the same thing now that we did when we were 12, just as grown-ups. Do you know what I'm trying to say?
I think another side to it as well is that we, especially when we first won, it was kind of a weird situation, because even for us it was kind of a case of, what do you do now with this big platform as a group of mates who do street dancing as Elle, quite clever people. It wasn't cool, so it was a weird one, because it was a, where do you go from here? And I remember you even coming to us and saying, we're going to put on a tour, we're going to go around the country, we're going to do this. Not only did people externally not kind of believe in it, even we in the group were a bit like,
it took me going to, I'd say 12 different promoters. I got turned down 11 times. Yeah. It will never work. You'll never sell tickets. Yeah. You can't put on a 2-hour show. I was like, watch me. And there was one promoter that we're still with today that does every single live show that we do that believed in us and said, look, I'll give you the shot. Gave us the guarantee, gave us the money, we advertised, and we sold the amount of tickets he put on for the whole tour in the first 24 hours. And then from then on, we went on to sell the O2 Arena 3 times. We went on to, you know, sell, I think we're approaching 1 million tickets now.
And that's the point. I feel like every year, whether it be through, you know, live performances, whether it be through people commissioning TV shows, different channels, whether it be getting radio shows, no matter what it is, there's kind of been, we do something, then there's a goal and we work towards it, and we kind of, like you said, let things organically grow and just kind of move towards that, as opposed to going, there's this huge plan, we need to wrestle this, this needs to go in that way, this needs to happen, because that's how stuff dies. Do you know what I'm saying?
Do you know what I love, Al?
Like, even now, right, 11 years on, we still have to prove ourselves, right? Whether it be in TV or live, because we'll always be the dancers. But I absolutely love being the underdog, like, because no one ever overestimates us. They always underestimate me. And I'm like, please continue doing that, because I will always then exceed your expectations, which allows us to be here all this time on, because people are just like, oh, it's only them. And then we'll always exceed it.
Do you know, I'm a massive fan of exactly what you said, in terms of just kind of, I hate when people overpromise and underdeliver.
Yeah,
and
it's the worst.
And you get it a lot.
It's the worst.
And we'll always overdeliver.
Always.
Because no one does nowadays. Because people do kind of the bare minimum. Mm-hmm. And of course, back in 2009, I'm trying to think what platforms were around in 2009. So Facebook and that was out. Was Insta out then?
Twitter. Just started picking up. And it was, because we had won. And we had won a couple months before. And was it Ben Shepherd?
Ben Shepherd set us up a Twitter account.
He was like, you guys need to get on Twitter. And he's the one who set up our account.
So we went to do an interview on...
Oh, that's a nice... Yeah,
on Good Morning Britain. I didn't know my Twitter password. I was like, Ben, could you give me my password for my Twitter account?
But did that make it easier or harder without social media? Because I guess you've only got the benefit of TV. Only. Mm-hmm. Got the benefit of TV, but I suppose then no other competition had got that benefit. But then how do you reach all these people when you're not... on TV?
I think that's such a good point, because especially back then, like now, that's why you've got so many people. Like we was all chatting earlier, right? And we were saying that you can get celebrities on TV who loads of people recognize when they walk down the street. But then you've got, you know, YouTube stars and influencers who are earning so much money and huge on social media. Because nowadays there's so much opportunity. You can literally make your own brand. If you've got a phone, you can make your own brand.
Trust me.
Do you know what I mean? It's nuts. Of course, a lot of hard work goes into it. But at that time as well, like you said, it was hard to have consistency, because it's like you go on TV and then it's like...
And then you're kind of nowhere then.
And it's like, where do you go from here?
We were the last wave. Literally probably the last active by a year who made it, if you like, without social media.
Literally.
In a way, sometimes now I look back and go, because I was only 20 when we won. And I look back and go, I wish I had more kind of like vision to sort of like see this thing emerging, because we could have been 2, 3, 4 times as big. But because I wasn't looking at it like I want to grow this business, I was just like, I'm with my mates and we're doing well. But honestly, like we were the last act to ever make it.
You were 20, I was 15.
Without the emergence of social media, we just were.
Do you know what, that's a nice point, because I think that, because when, you know, people always say, and you must get it all the time, oh, you've made it, you've got there, but you won't think like that.
No, you'll just think,
but there's loads we want to do.
Yeah,
because you're driven. And that's really important, that you don't ever think you've get there, because you know, you don't know where there is. But I look back and I think, oh God, you know, not as in I wish I'd known that then, because you can't know that, but yeah, I wish we'd sort of jumped on Facebook soon and Instagram soon. But the same point, I wasn't really trying to grow the brand as such. I was kind of just having fun. And then just kind of making product for people who thought would get benefit from them.
Exactly the same.
And that was it, really.
Same thing.
But you think, actually, we could have kind of made it a bigger business quicker. Mm-hmm. But you know what? I would say it's like filling the bath, isn't it? You can sort of, you know, eventually, even just with one tap slightly on, eventually you'll fill the bath, you know.
Fair enough.
You can stand and put both taps on and whatever, but it just takes time. And I think it's really important, like I said, the best brands and businesses, they take time. The ones that kind of appear overnight and they've got all the theatre and look like they do really well, they go just as quickly. And it's really important, you kind of want to start to stand the test of time. Because again, your original fans then, I guess, who were probably similar age to yourself when they saw you win, I guess they've all kind of grown up with you. So do you have the same fans now, and I guess you're getting new ones that probably weren't born when that show was on?
And that is the weirdest part. Sometimes we meet people, we'll be on tour now, and someone will come up and be like, oh, and they'll get out a picture and they'll be like them with Perry, and they're both like the same age. And they'll be like, you know, 25, 26, and they're standing there with their 8-year-old kid who's like, oh, they love watching you on YouTube. And I'm like, you wasn't even born when we were one, and your mum was coming to watch us on tour when she was like 13, 14. It's like the weirdest thing.
It's the craziest thing.
It's weird when you know their moms, personally.
But it's kind of been a case of like...
We'll move on.
Yeah. Moving swiftly on.
Yeah, moving swiftly on.
Best way to get out of a hole is stop digging.
I'm going to use that bit of advice from now on.
Because I was thinking as well, because you mentioned Perry, but I've heard a rumour as well that Perry's the real talent behind you guys, and he's been carrying you for years. Perry told me that himself. It's not actually a rumour, it's a fact.
No, it's not a rumour. I used to keep him quite a small cage, and then
bring
him out for performances and meet and greets and just earn money off him.
That's allowed. What can possibly go wrong? Because how old was he then when you won? Because he's the one again, people remember them.
But, so. Yeah, 12 or 13. Yeah,
13.
But yeah, because I was 16. Yeah, so 13. Yeah.
And he was kind of a small 13 as really well, wasn't he? He actually looked younger than that.
He grew up really late. He was a late bloomer.
He's now like... Because everyone still thinks about him like he's Peter Pan and just never grows. But he's now like 6'2", 6'3", but that only happened in like the past 2 years. Like, it wasn't until, like, he hit, like, 2021 that he had a growth spur. And, like, before that, he literally stayed exactly the same.
Well, he's 25 on his next birthday.
Yeah,
he's
like, nuts.
It's crazy.
Well, prior to that, he was just hair, wasn't he? So he was just, like, hair and 2 feet.
Yeah, yeah, hair and lenses.
Do you know the Wombles? He was a bit like a Womble.
Literally.
Yeah, so probably a bit like a, but a friendly one. Were the Wombles unfriendly?
No, I think they were quite friendly.
Yeah, I think they were quite friendly, weren't they? Yeah, fair enough.
Business, brand, banter, Wombles.
Wombles.
That's what we're doing.
We're already on to the Wombles. But then, and obviously the dancing's still massive for you guys, but they're now doing other stuff. Obviously you mentioned more TV work. Jordan, you've just literally started on the radio a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
Enjoying the 3 a.m.
Superstar
starts.
DJ!
You know what? So that was something again that I think is a really random one, because I feel the TV world, the media industry, it's like a really hard one to find something. It's really easy to get caught up in just going from job to job to find the next thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's really easy to do that. And me and Ash were talking about it, me and Pell were talking about it, and it was like finding something where you felt like you could be authentic, have fun, be like, basically you have the dream job, right? That's what everyone wants to do, right?
Yeah. Apart from the 3 a.m. start.
Exactly. So we went for a random meeting with KISS at the start of 2019, and they gave us a graveyard shift, like 7 to 11 on Sunday. We came in once a week. We did that. You know, we probably had about 3 listeners. And then we moved to the Saturday breakfast show.
I wasn't one of them, by the way.
Me and Pell were 2 of them. My mum was the last one. So that was good. And then literally within a year and a half, we're now on the breakfast show. And I think it's kind of like everything we kind of do. Once we have a goal, we just kind of sink our teeth into it and just go. Yeah.
You know what, though? On that note, like in our industry as well, and I'm sure with you as well, Al, the whole world will want to tell you what you are and what you can do and what you can be. Yeah. And I'm like, listen, I'm like, if we'd listened to that like 10 years ago, number one, if we'd listened to that, we would never have won the show because we weren't the winners. Susan Boyle was like global superstar. She was global superstar.
That wasn't even rehearsed.
No, it was actually in tune, weren't
They'd
it?
They'd be dying to do that,
But you know what? We just don't listen to people. We're just like, if we can do this, like your radio host, we'll be TV host, we'll be dancers, we'll be whatever it is, we'll just give it a go, right? And I think that's really important. Don't let people just like box you in.
Yeah.
Just never let people box you in, 100%.
And you know what I think probably underpins a lot of this? I think it's just that discipline and the ability to, like you say, dig in and kind of just do it. I think what underpins this probably is training.
Yeah.
Simple training. Like I started training when I was 13, 14 years old, just weight training.
Yeah.
And, you know, couldn't afford to, I mean, gyms didn't really exist sort of back then, back in the day, but got like a, you know, weight set from Argos and sort of made a bench and, you know, improvised and just having that discipline to do it every day, even when you still look like a sack of shit. and you just get sand kicked in your face and stuff's not bringing back memories, but anyway. But having the discipline to do it and stick at it, I think is a really useful skill to learn when you're a teenager and just putting the weights out, putting them away.
Yep.
Because people give up really easily on things. And it's a flakier generation now, I think, in terms of, because you can get things so quickly. Everything's at your fingertips with phones and stuff. I think a bit of that discipline and the ability to kind of dig in and do something for like 2, 3, 4, 5 years, people just don't do now. I'm not saying that's wrong, but it's just a different trait from a different generation.
I think like the weird part is even looking at it from a narrower scope, like the TV side of things. When I was speaking to people, it's really weird. We do like a lot of meet and greets, and I remember there was this young girl there. I think her name was like Lauren or something. She was like, "Oh, I sing, and I really want to make a career in that." And her mum was like, "Do you have any advice?" And it was her and her mum who said it to me. And I was like, "That is." It was just weird to hear. So what, do you want to go down like the X Factor route? Or do you want to, she was like, well, I'm thinking like when I get a bit older, I'll do Love Island. And I was like, wow, what a weird path.
And there's nothing wrong with Love Island.
Nothing wrong with it. But I mean, like to see that as the gateway,
as the
to be like, let me get a platform, then I can say I sing.
Yeah.
But the goal is singing, but it's like, no, let me go down a quick route. Yeah. To initially get a platform.
Oh, and I was like,
and it's not the way. It's not the way.
It's not the way. It's not
people. You hear one minute, not the next. They say it to me. Yeah. They're like, what do you have any advice? And I'm like, what do you want to do? And I'm like, I want to be a dancer. Or sometimes it's not even a dancer. And I say, okay. I'm like, well, for me, there's two ways to do it. You need to be the best and then put yourself out there. And they're like, yeah, but like, how do I do that? I'm like, working hard. Literally, put yourself out there and be the best. Simple as that.
People always want to know what the one thing is. They only ever want one thing.
Yeah, what's the shortcut?
So what's the one thing that you need to do? Or how? What's
I
the,
wish.
And you always go, I just think, and I always give the same answer. I go, do you know what the one thing is you need to do? And they go, what? I said, you need to do everything.
Everything. Yeah.
And then you need to put in, you know, obviously all the hard work and all that sort of stuff, but you need to have a world-class product or service, in my case.
Simple as that.
In your case, you've got to be a world-class dancer.
Simple as that.
You've got to understand social media. You've got to work really hard at it. You need a certain element of I don't want to say luck, but you need timing on your side.
Timing's key.
Agreed. You can't change that. You know, the moment you're in is the moment you're in.
Absolutely.
You know, so you can't change that. But then there's always, like, you know, with us, we just did loads of sampling, loads of shows. You know, we're taking tanks into shows. And I genuinely cannot think of anything we didn't do.
But that's the thing. I actually hate sitting here bigging you up to your face, but...
Oh, no, please carry on.
God, this is why I hate it. Your product is the best. I'm just not blowing smoke up your ass. It's the best, and that's why I'm like, well, obviously the preparation, the hard work, and the marketing, and the way that you do things is incredible. But like, your product's the best. Simple as that.
At the core of it, that's what matters, right? It's amazing.
I taste those bars, for example, and I go, I'd rather eat this than something that's supposed to be not good or supposed to be. You know what I mean? It's amazing. That's why it's successful.
I'm welling up.
Honestly, mate. That's from me to you. That's from me to you, Al.
And that's the end of the show. Yeah. Thanks, guys. Bye, perfect. Guys.
Boom, boom. Boom, boom.
Now, that means a lot. And that's why we love working with you guys, because you see all these similarities and stuff. But just, I think, you know, with us, we've got this world-class team, the passion with what we do, and we never go for the easy route. People always look for the easy route. Maybe we should try and look for easier shortcuts, but I just don't know what they are. I don't know how to make things better quicker. It just takes time. Yeah. And, you know, when we launched our bar, we spent 2 years working on that because everyone said it couldn't be done. And, you know, we're sort of plugging away at it for literally years. And again, everyone's saying you can't do it. You'll never do it. And I think obviously it was hard, but no one else had kind of bothered. Now everyone has to kind of, everyone that wants to make, you know, our sort of bars, they have to make a better bar because we've kind of literally raised the bar. There's still loads of bad product out there, which still surprises me because... you know, it's going to be nowhere when you think of the standard that sort of, you know, we set. Yeah. And that's the same. So, you know, with you guys setting that bar so high, everyone else around you, all your contemporaries, you know, competitors, and they've got to get better.
Yeah.
But then you guys have still got to stay up there and still keep improving.
Yeah, which we love. It's part of it.
Well, it keeps you on your toes. Yeah. I mean, clearly, as well as the dancing, you must be into like, other forms of health and fitness. I mean, what else are you guys doing in addition, you know, to the dance? I mean, what else are you doing?
What's funny, you know, we don't, like, if I wrote you out like our 6-day training schedule, I'd say we train dance maybe, I'd say dance is about a quarter of it.
Mm.
The rest of it is just functional movement and being able to, for example, like movement and strength and how you get like gains, so to speak. Like, people are quite specific, like they'll train a specific muscle group for a specific set of gains in an area. And I'm sort of like, no, if you do this, trust me, you'll get gains everywhere just by doing this. Or people are like lifting this weight and doing that. We've never been into that. We train sort of like really functional, really body weight. We use weights, obviously, but like, we're sort of just about becoming better movers. Like, I want to be 50, 60, being like as mobile as I was.
That's my goal.
When I was 20. Mm-hmm. And I'm serious about it. Like, I want to be playful. Like, I want to be able to like bend down and do stuff and be able to just like, literally, like, what was it, George? Remember them fitness tests that we spoke about? Like, when someone used to come to me and say, oh, Ash, could you write me out like a little program? I'd say, okay, right, these are the tests. Firstly, I want you to sit on the floor and stand back up. Can you reach into the bottom cupboard underneath the sink to get a product out? Can you do a forward roll? Can you do a cartwheel?
All those random little
things. All those random movements.
Yes, to all of that, by the way.
Can you do all those?
Tick, tick, tick.
I would put those in a test and do it out.
I can't do a forward roll. But I'd end up kind of on my side, sandwiched up against the skirting board. Probably.
Honestly.
Yeah. I'm not even joking, to be honest.
I remember, like, I had a friend, remember, Jordan? I'm not gonna name him, but like he can pull like.
Please name him.
I'm not gonna name. I don't want to out him. It's not Perry.
Definitely not me.
When I tell you the story, it's definitely not Perry. But he can do like a, what was he? He can pull like a 260 kilo squat. But
it's me.
I remember it's definitely. Can you do a 260 kilo squat?
Oh, easy. Warm up.
Oh, I'd love to see that. But I remember he could do a 260
with
kilo
one leg,
squat, right?
With the other leg, I'm stretching.
Oh, one leg. And then I remember he twisted his ankle once stepping off a curve. And I was
typical.
And I was like, don't you find that funny? That you can do a...
You've got all that
you
strength.
Can do a, you've got all applicable. That strength,
yeah.
But you haven't got... You can twist your ankle stepping off a... I just find that...
It's that functional fitness.
I'm obsessed with it.
So I was obsessed with kind of being... I was always really skinny and sort of quite weak.
Mm-hmm.
I say always, as in I'm not now, clearly.
Fairly
hench. No, I was really into like... I was obsessed with being strong when I was like a late teen. And I was obsessed with what I could lift and stuff. And I realised then, I spent years kind of doing sort of like bodybuilding and whatever, and then afterwards, I sort of realised, actually, I'm not that bothered about what I look like. It's more about how I feel.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because when I looked my best, I probably felt my worst.
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it?
And you're right. You focus on kind of all the big muscle grips, like the squatting, and then, yeah, you'll see me like pull off some crazy dance move, and then I'll put my neck out. You do it because you don't strengthen all these little stabilising muscles and stuff as well. And we were saying earlier that basically, I think, you know, the key to all this stuff is having, you know, that flexibility, fitness and strength in the right combinations.
All in the
when
right
you've kind
combo.
Of got too much of one almost, as you get older, that balance just isn't there.
Absolutely.
But it's exactly what I want to be. You know, a doctor said to me years ago, and I was, again, squatting 400 kilos. I wasn't. When I was squatting a lot and stuff, and he was like, you're going to be in a wheelchair when you're 40.
Yeah, you know, if you're not careful.
Really, you are going to, you're wearing everything out. But again, 20, 30 years ago, people didn't know what that functional fitness was. There weren't Swiss balls and balance balls, and there weren't foam rollers, and we sort of didn't know then what we know now.
So now
you're sort of growing up, and this stuff's fucking far more readily available. Again, I wish I'd known all the health and fitness stuff that I know now. Back then, I wish I'd known
that's
that. Because you do kind of wear your body out. I mean, again, you were saying before about your knees and stuff like that. It's so hard on your body. Do you worry about sort of the longevity of some of this in terms of like the wear and tear on your body?
I mean, sometimes, I mean, like, it's funny because I'm only 27.
You know? So you worry about longevity is 27.
Yeah, I'm only 27. But like, Ash has kind of always been, you've kind of always pulled us in that direction. I only started training because
properly
when you kind of dragged me through, like kicking and screaming to do it. And I only did it initially to help improve dancing. That was the only reason I did. And then it kind of just sort of becomes a lifestyle, right?
It's addictive, isn't it? Yeah, but it has to be a lifestyle. It can't just be, I've got to go to the gym or whatever. No. You have to make it part. You have to embrace that 100%. Lifestyle. Definitely.
And I think before that, I started getting injuries from when I was like 15, 16, didn't I? I started doing like little things like tearing cartilage in one knee. And then slowly the things started getting bigger. So like I started tearing ligaments in my ankles, and then I ripped ligaments in both my knees, and I've had to have surgery and stuff. And it was because I was trying to do all this crazy stuff. Like Ash would like just shake his head and I'd walk into rehearsal. You'd lucky if I did a 30-second warm-up, but I'd just come in. You know when you're young and you just sort of bounce back. Yeah. You're like, oh, I'll be fine. And now I'm only 27, but like...
The repercussions
of it already, there's certain things that I'm like, oof, like it's hard
but,
to
but
do.
But let's paint the picture, Georgia, just so obviously everyone's in the know. You at that age, you were, what were you, 24 stone?
Yeah, 20, like 23 and a half, and I was like 16.
You were 23 stone at 16.
And bear in mind, really,
so this is after you've won.
When we won BGT, I mean, like, honestly, pull up some clips. I was like, Jordan was
did
like,
you celebrate for a year or something.
No. I'd be like, he was.
No, it was silly.
He was mad.
And again, as well, all jokes aside, like there was just a complete lack of understanding of like any like nutrition, like anything at all. Even when I was dancing, even when I started training at first.
Yeah. Unless there still is. Mate, people just don't understand basics.
Yeah.
And you can't educate them because it's too difficult.
No.
So to be fair, what we started to do, sorry to butt in here, what we started to do actually was just people don't know it's a problem.
Yeah.
So, and you can't educate them because they don't understand. And how do you go about doing it? Because you can't educate, you know, the UK or Europe or the world.
Yeah.
So to be honest, we just started, and people always talk about taste. So people love chocolate, for instance. So we thought, okay, we've got to make something better that tastes as good as that.
Yeah.
And then you've got to put it in all the locations that people go to.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got to make it so it's a seamless switch.
Yeah, so smart, yeah.
Which sort of sounds really easy, but it's really difficult because it's time.
It's
you know, where the government have tried to get involved with this, and they've said, oh yeah, you know, don't eat chocolate, eat carrots. Well, people aren't going to do
that.
They're not going to go, oh, I really want a Mars bar, but I'll just have a carrot. So if you kind of just do it for people and make it easier, you stand a fighting chance.
Mm-hmm. But that's what I had to do for myself. I remember when I was first learning about it, because when we won, we were just like I said, a group of guys. We weren't professional at all. We just had a talent and we didn't know what we were doing. And I remember sitting there thinking, I need to step up. I need to sort myself out because I think my body's now my like, this is my thing.
This is it, yeah.
So I remember like spending like literally maybe 5-6 years. I started to get really deep, didn't I, Jordan, into training and nutrition. Mm-hmm. And I remember making those changes for myself. Like I need to feel like I'm not making any sacrifices in order to see this through.
Yeah.
Because if I have to come in and eat a carrot instead of a Mars bar, there's no way
you're
I'm sticking to it long term.
It's not sustainable.
So I was like, I started to get into like understand calories and macro and micronutrients and understand that actually it's because I'm a scientist as well by trade. I did actually do science at uni. So
I was going to ask you if you had any other jobs actually.
I studied natural science. So like once I realised that like it was more of a numbers game and actually your body's quite predictable, I was like, oh, actually I can sub this in and sub that out and work this and work that and actually eat what feels like a normal day for me, but treat my body really well. And once I started to understand the science of it, I was like, I'm away. And until this day, I feel better now than I did when I was 19.
Awesome. And consistency as well. I'm massive on consistency. Every day. So people can do anything for a bit, can't they? But you've got to be able to do it consistently, really, to try and achieve, absolutely. You know, say success or whatever. You've got to really plug away at it.
Yeah, defo.
And then, you know, you're going to have sort of highs and lows. Uh-huh. So, you know, I'm a big fan of like, if you want something, just go and kind of eat it.
Yeah, definitely.
You can't do it daily. And you can get away with certain things, but... to the point, where you're 23 stone at 16.
I know,
I mean, so what did you weigh then? When you won BGT, what did you weigh
when
you were 15?
Bro, I was like, I just never...
I'm trying to the maths. You must have put like 6, 7...
No, bro. When we won Britain's Got Talent, I was that big.
Really? I don't remember that.
Yeah, I was that big.
Was that when there were just the two of you on stage? Because we're literally just with you and then...
We used to put wide-angle lens. Yeah, we used to put multiple outfits on him, so he looked like a group.
It was meant... But then I went completely the other way. By the time I was 17, I weighed 12 stone. I went crashed.
I was looking at you on TV thinking, well, they said the camera put £7 on you, so I just thought you got 30 cameras on you or something.
Simple maths.
I just don't remember you being. I'm gonna go look back at the pictures.
Literally, bro, it was mad. It literally affected.
Did you do that? No wonder you hurt your ankles.
Oh, mate, no.
Joey did. It was at the height of his sort of how do I put this, like largeness, and he
it was the height of his largeness.
And he jumped off the stage just trying to follow us. He used to jump off the stage at the end of the first half and run back. He jumped off the stage and broke his ankle.
Yeah, that's my ankle.
That was the incentive. Jumping off the stage was like double me.
I don't know who I was running and jumping off that stage. That was confidence.
You put a lot of faith in those ankles.
Oh no! And then literally, I landed, and my ankles were popped.
Damn those ankles! I hate that where your ankles give up and they snap because of the sheer weight. Yeah. So saying that now, because obviously everyone's super busy. How are you finding kind of balancing all the training, all the home life, the sort of eating healthier? You know, just the way you work. How do you find? Because people struggle with that. So
I struggle all the time. I speak to Ash all the time because especially now, like where we've been prepping the Kiss Breakfast Show, then I'm coming away and trying to do training and this and that. And obviously, I've got two kids. I've got my fiance at home. Like everything. Especially throughout lockdown as well, because I'm the sort of person like I think it annoys me more as well, where I actually have an understanding of the nutritional value of what I'm doing, but I still do it.
And
that annoys me. When you don't know, you can quite just like ignorance is bliss. But when you know what you're doing and you still do it, and literally I'll ring Ash the next day and I'll go, man, I just don't know why I've like what I've been doing the past couple of weeks. I'm like, why I'm eating a tube of Pringles. And I'm like, what are you doing? Do you know what I mean? Like it's I really easily fall into bad habits. It's like a comfort sort of thing. And it kind of gets me through.
Do you know what? It's really common as well.
It's so really easy common. To do. So you know, easy
what my
to
thing
do.
Is eating in the night. I eat in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
Been doing it for years. Been doing it for years. Get up like 2 o'clock in the morning. But I know I'm gonna go wandering around the house looking for stuff. Mm-hmm. And generally I'm quite good, like I don't buy junk, I don't really want it in the house, because if it's there, I've got very addictive personality, I'll eat it.
You ain't gotta worry, you'd burn the calories walking around this house. By the time you get to the fridge, you've earned those calories. He's calling up to the fridge like, please.
Joking aside, I've got to tell you, the first week I moved into this house, I lost half a stone.
Yeah, but I'm not surprised. That was just him interviewing. Yeah.
So we used to have competitions on Fitbit. Do you remember Fitbit?
Yeah.
We'd have competitions on Fitbit at work. It's like, who could do 30,000 steps? And I'd always win.
Exactly. There we go, that's done.
And he was like, what have you been doing? You think, well, I just went for a piss, to be honest.
Oh, I love it. I love it. I love that.
So I could rack up the steps fairly easily. But now what I do now is I put a shake next to the bed and a bar.
Yes.
I'll probably have one or the other or both. Yeah. I mean, again, if I can get up and kind of have neither, great. Uh-huh. But at least if I drink a shake, then I've had a couple of calories, I've had protein, I've had no sugar, it kind of then, it's quite comforting at night because it's kind of milk-based, but there's no sugar. So then you just sort of, it feels like it satisfies your sweet tooth.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then I can sort of go back to sleep again. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, to your point, I'm wandering around the house looking for Pringles. Yeah, I know there aren't any there. I do the shop and I open drawers and know they're not in there. But I'm looking for stuff, like a crack addict.
Yeah.
On gyro day, And I'm literally out and looking for stuff. And I know, I know it's not there. Yeah. But I'll eat anything. Cat food. But I think it's like a form of sleepwalking. So that's my thing. Mm. But then yours is just because you've got to have junk in the house because the kids.
I just graze. Like, I'll plan my meals and I'm like, I know, like, these are my macros, this is half set, I've got everything done. And then I just start grazing. And I'm like, why? And this is what I try and explain, like, I try and explain to Nay all the time. Like, she's the sort of person where I'll be chatting to her about something. She'll go, yeah, but I mean, like let's say I was like, right, I'm going to go Nando's, or I'm going to eat clean. I eat chicken and rice at Nando's. I'll come home, she'll make a full lasagna or something, right? She'll be like, nice. And I'll go, I can't eat that. And she'll go, why? I'm like, oh, macros, and you just had a takeaway, that's worse. And that's the mindset. Yeah. Because you've eaten like outdoors and it's not like a home cooked meal.
Georgia, we'll be eating chicken and rice and someone will be eating a salad covered in dressing and they'll go, at least one of us is eating healthy.
And I'm like, no, you're not. It doesn't work like that.
No, you're not.
Yeah. People get this weird thing in their head.
And do you know what as well? It's not just the type of food. Because chicken and rice is, you know, fine if you have takeaway food. I think it's how it's prepared. It's still probably
hidden calories.
I think because it's processed en masse.
Not
slagging off Nando's, but... Again, I think, you know, you just don't know how good the ingredients are.
Yeah, no.
You know, any sort of fast food place, they're churning food quickly and it has to be, you know, they have to make a profit. Mm-hmm. And you just, I wonder still, although it's probably the right type of food, how nutritious it probably is.
That's almost like a different level.
There's health and then there's weight.
There's health and then there's like weight, isn't there? And it's like, if you want to get into, I mean, I dread to think nowadays what goes into what. Yeah. I mean, it's just crazy, isn't it? It's
like, we've shown you the veg garden stuff here, so we're kind of like growing veg and
man.
Just because then you sort of know,
what's
in it. But yeah, I've just found that health becomes more and more and more important
to you,
especially everything we've gone through this year with COVID and stuff. But health's kind of key. If you can do that and be healthy and happy and
health is
wealth, sustainable, and you don't feel like you're missing out on things. That's got to be kind of like the key to happiness.
100%.
Yeah, those foundations to go and kind of plug away at doing all this stuff. Mm-hmm. If those foundations are there with just healthy stuff, you know, and you don't kind of feel like you're missing out.
Exactly.
That's huge.
But just to caveat this conversation, I love nothing more than tucking into a doner kebab. I'm just letting you know, like, really like, don't laugh at that, Jordy. Any sort of like,
that's not a euphemism.
That's not a euphemism.
It was going there. It was like,
why'd you have to?
I was a little bit slower on that comment.
here we go.
But it's true though. Like, I feel like people hear us talk about this stuff and think, oh, then they're health freaks. I'm like, no, trust me. Like,
yeah, definitely not.
I'm not that at all. I just, you know.
But that's, you see, that's not my thing. Like, I wouldn't dream of having a doner kebab. My thing's probably if I was going to go and have something, probably be McDonald's.
McDonald's.
What's in it?
It's mad.
Now that's crack addict stuff.
Addictive.
You could see how mad it is. Where like I could hurt I've had injuries before. I've like broke arms, fingers. And I've gone, I'm not going to the hospital. It's like a 4-hour queue. They reopened McDonald's after COVID. 5-hour queues. And I'm sitting there salivating at my wheel. I ain't moving. It's madness.
It's mad.
I wondered who was doing that, but that was you.
It was me.
Yeah, I was there too.
Isn't that bizarre that we've been through the worst health crisis the planet's ever seen?
I know.
And then, the queues for the fast food restaurants.
It's
been bigger than ever.
It's psychological because it makes you feel good. Do you know what I mean?
And it's stuff when you can't have something and then the option's put back there, everyone's going to jump in.
Yeah,
it's
mad. Humans are funny.
Yeah, weird. Like,
yeah,
we're a funny lot, aren't we?
So I've got to ask you some about funny things. Would you guys class yourselves as entrepreneurs? Has that ever been put to you before?
No.
Would you?
Well, not to me.
Not you. I suppose.
Because you are to me.
It depends, Joel, doesn't it? Like, there's. In diversity, we have to like focus on different parts of the business. So like for me, like I have to be, because otherwise you can't. I have to lead the business side of it, because no matter how great your product is, right? Number one, unless you tell people about it and unless you market it in the right way, unless you put it out there and consistently deliver and make connections with people.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
And somewhere it's fine doing what you love, but somewhere you've got to live.
You've got to make money.
Yeah, man.
But our challenge for me is to sort of like, strike that balance between diversity being a family and not sort of like ever polluting the idea of what we are at our heart, but monetizing it just enough so that it makes sense. So I'm a sort of like entrepreneur in a sense of like, I absolutely know that I haven't maximized what we have, but that has allowed us to maintain our bubble. So it's almost like I have to understand it so deeply that I know when to let off. Do you know what I'm trying to say?
Rather, no, definitely.
Otherwise, I could have just gone, franchise the brand out, merchandise left, right and centre, put the name above these people, build a pyramid scheme, have them teaching
you can't
me,
do all that.
Dilute diversity down to the point where dance could be everywhere, but it wouldn't be us.
No.
Yeah.
And it's really important you realise that because that's how people
You could have blitzed it in 5 years. I could have blitzed it in 5 years
and earned a ton of money, but we still wouldn't be here. And I feel like the reason that we are here is because it's our life. We love what we do. It will be here for 10, 20, 30 years. And so in a way, absolutely, I have to think about more stuff like that. But I also don't let that rule me. Loads of decisions I make, I know are not business decisions. I'll give stuff away and do things and go places because I want to.
But we do all that. So I regret saying this now on the radio, but I've kind of got this thing where I was trying to help military charities, for instance, which people have kind of cottoned onto. Mm-hmm. So I find it really hard to say no and stuff. So, and you can't do everything for everyone. There's all this sort of head and heart stuff and whatever, but we always try and do the right thing. Mm-hmm. And you know, you always know what the right and wrong thing is. Kind of everyone knows right and wrong stuff. And there's kind of decisions that you make that, of course, aren't right from a business perspective, but if they're kind of right culturally, I just sort of believe that the right solution will you'll get there anyway.
Exactly.
Someone said to me once, actually, he said, I can't work you out, Ali. Said, you can buy something for a tenner and you could kind of sell it for a fiver, but somehow you've made money.
Yeah, it's a compliment. Absolutely.
But it was just, somehow you'll monetize this, but not in an obvious kind of, dirty, obvious. Scheming sort of way where you're just kind of making money out of people in that sense. Although obviously we do want to make money out of people. But so you said as well, something interesting about sort of not polluting the brand. So, and the diversity is the people obviously including and especially you guys. Have you ever had the wrong people come into the brand that, have just not been right? It hasn't worked. They say one bad apple spoils the barrel.
Do you know what?
Apart from Jordan, obviously.
The thing is, right, when we first won, obviously Ash, leader, front man, led the business side as well as the public side as well. You had Perry, hair, afro, everyone knew him. Do you know what I mean? It was kind of Ash and Pell, kind of like the faces of the group, right? And as that kind of developed, like as years went on, it kind of became like a bit of a thing for me. I used to get really worried about being that person that would, potentially do something that would mess up the brand. And beforehand,
doing what specifically?
And that's anything. Like, I kind of think I became so obsessed with, even at a young age, like 15, 16 when we won, of making sure that we had this kind of like, even though, of course, I wanted like to earn money and do nice things, it was kind of like this idea of like a legacy to me. I was like, that's what I want to do. And then the opportunity came up to go and like, I'm a celeb. And it was, I said no initially. I was like, I can't do it. It was Ash who convinced me to. Ash was like, Jules, you've got to go and do this. You know, you've got to future proof. You've got to do stuff for yourself as well.
Yeah.
And because I was really happy to kind of have like the benefit of both worlds. So like Ash said, we'd go out, we'd perform to 15,000 people in the O2, have sellout tours, but then I'd walk down the high street and no one have any idea. Like it meant nothing to anyone else because Ash and Pell, diversity was famous as a brand and everyone recognised Ash and Pell, but that was it. So I was happy to have, basically have my cake and eat it, literally, back then. You know.
That's quite nice in a way, because a lot of people wouldn't necessarily like that.
Yeah.
As in, like, potentially just kind of like being, a number two or whatever. Yeah.
Bro, because we still got everything we wanted to do.
You're more talented, like, brother.
Yeah.
I'll take that back. More talented, better looking. More talented, better looking, funnier.
At one point, you said one of us was talented and one of us was better looking. You can't take that back.
Then we'll do a quick fire round in a minute. I want to know what you guys think.
There's going to be some very, very deep and meaningful
questions.
Okay, nice.
Not conjured up by me when I was on the loo this morning at last minute. No, we have got whole teams of people that actually look into this sort of stuff. I mean, very loosely, obviously. But we will come to that. So yeah, definitely stay tuned for that. Ooh. And actually, that reminded me as well. Sorry, we've cut in. You were saying about how Ash was better than you.
So, along those lines, but you got the idea.
That's really nice, actually, because we've had this before, say, at Grenade, where you think, actually, can I be CEO forever, because you don't necessarily, because there's a lot of pressure and it can be quite lonely. You probably feel sometimes it's kind of quite lonely. You feel everything's
on your shoulders. Yeah.
And you need all the people around you kind of frankly doing all the clever stuff and making you look good.
Literally.
But Yeah, like Jordan.
Cheers. But, one compliment in there. That works.
Yeah, but I've sort of said to people at Grenade in the past over the years, like, you know, sort of wonder, like, you know, do you want to be CEO or whatever? And they've gone, actually, no, I don't. Mm-hmm. They've, you know, so they've, sort of, they've said, like, I'd rather be a number two, and I kind of enjoy that.
I which actually is really week, nice.
But that's an amazing skill, though, for someone to be able to say that, because it's really, really rare.
It's an absolute skill, and being able to know where you function. That, for me, is the sign of a healthy company.
Know your place is what you meant to say, but it was...
Basically, yeah. You're put politely...
Know your place.
Know your place. Know what you do best. Because if Jordan had to do the job I did, the difference is that he could absolutely do it. But right now...
I don't doubt that, yeah.
Is he better placed to do it than me? No, but then I'm not better placed to do what Jordan does than he does. And when Jordan's out there working and he's on Kiss FM and he's doing this, he's making people laugh and bringing that joy to people, he doesn't even realise the fact that he's extending our brand to people in a completely different way. I couldn't do what Jordan does.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And all of that stuff...
I needed this. I needed
this. Nice, and that's what we do as a group. Like, we function as a group. And so, like, I'm different to Jord, who's different to Pell. And that's the other hard thing as well. Like, over the years, we've had to sort of wrestle with that, like, number one, number two, whose face is out there, who's in it, but who's not famous for it. But actually, we realise that we all bring something different. And once we all know that and we all knuckle down, we're the same group of guys that we were 15 years ago.
Yeah.
Because we all know how we work. And me being successful or doing something means nothing if they're not with me. Do you know what I mean?
So definitely.
So you know, we all move
as a team. That's kind of been like the group motto, whether it was me in the jungle, you doing dancing on ice, Pell doing this, whatever's happening. Mm-hmm. It's kind of always like wherever one of us goes, the group follows. There's always an avenue for it to benefit everyone if you just if you just come at it from that angle. Mm. And as it goes round, back full circle, if Ash wanted to rinse everything that diversity was for the first few years, make bank for himself, you know, give everyone else a few trimmings, Ash could have done that, but it hasn't been that. You know, we've kind of built it, and everything we've gone at, it's kind of like longevity. How do you bring 100%. Everyone else through? How do you make the most of this opportunity, not just from a selfish point of view, but how does it develop?
But that comes back to you guys just doing things the right way, and it just honestly, it just shows in abundance with everything you do it the right way. You know, the show of the day.
Long game, long game, thank you. Long game.
Oh, absolutely,
long game.
But so I'll say this differently then. So with the diversity as you've got older, has it been difficult keeping that cohesion with just other people's priorities taking, you know, so again, having kids now, I take it lots of the group members have had kids and got kids in their own lives. Has that been kind of hard to keep together and keep as a unit?
In some instances, people have come and gone. It isn't like, even though we're like the same
that's
group.
Life and,
And we've also got people now who were like, do you know, there's at least four or five people in diversity who were like, oh my God, I remember coming to like your first tour and you're the reason I started dancing. Now I talk to them about business decisions as a peer.
They've come
round after a decade and now in it dancing next to me, helping us make the next choices. And I find that so inspiring. I'm like, they're going to do that for someone else and so on.
And they get it.
They absolutely get it.
Really hard to get other people to get it.
Oh my
God. That makes sense. Because you just kind of know this stuff.
Yeah.
If you can find those people, grab them with both hands because they are really, really difficult.
Really
difficult to find. Because if I think of like, if I liken it to kind of a, you know, a pop group, so to say, they just don't stay together because they all fall out and all the infighting starts and you're more famous than me and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, it's nonsense.
And they just don't. And it's a shame, really, when they kind of have been, but I think they'll probably just get burned out with it as well.
Mm. Yeah, man.
Absolutely. You can't sustain it. It's not sustainable. No.
Speaking of sustainable, now, we normally do this at the end, right? And I was going to do it at the start because people might find it difficult to sort of, I mean, not me, obviously, but people might find it difficult to know who was who. So we actually got you something as well. So this was going to be some badges, but apparently it was too difficult to make. So look at this, you see. We've got A&J, no expense spared on the show. Amazon's finest. There you
cheers.
Go. Right, for you.
Let's go.
I've got quite a large head, so this
would
be fun.
Also, you can't keep these because we've decided as well that it also works for Al and Jenny.
Nice. Oh my, of course it does.
See what we did there. So those are on loan for the next 10 minutes or so.
Does it fit your head?
No. Oh, look at that. Stylish. That is stylish. Right, so I'm going to just...
Screenshot. Done now.
Nice. I could talk to you guys all day, but I'm gonna literally... And I'd love to talk about cars, and we probably don't really got time.
Let's do it.
You're both into cars, right? So we love our cars.
Love it.
We'll talk about cars again later. But favourite car? Dream car?
Do you know what? Because I used to always go, I want a GT2 RS, right? Porsche GT2 RS. But now, for all-round functionality, speed, I love the new 911 Turbo S. I'm a big Porsche fan. The new 911 Turbo S.
I had a Turbo S.
You did. You had the convertible one.
Oh, really?
It's ridiculous.
I'm not a Porsche guy, weird. I can't go.
You're not a Porsche guy?
No, not really.
I don't. They don't have the drama.
I'll go one further. I have never sat in a Porsche.
Really?
You're not a Porsche guy,
I
then?
I think so.
Really?
Yeah, you don't know if you're not a Porsche guy.
Wow, do you know what? Do you know why? There's this thing, right? It depends how you look at like a supercar. If you want to get in and have an experience, like for example, if you've got a weekend car, the Porsche isn't necessarily the one.
Yeah, but agreed.
My Porsche was my daily. And I kept that magic with it for the entire 2 years I had it every day. I got in it and it astonished me every
Some
time I
Some cars just do that.
Yeah. Honestly, it's amazing. It's amazing.
You got your Hurricane, right?
Yeah, Performante.
Yeah, Performante. Yeah.
That car as well. If you're talking about drama from a car,
drama,
the noise, the drive, like it's rare to get in a car that I feel that you can drive. You feel like you might kill yourself, but it's controlled. That's the part.
I feel like
me.
That in any car, pretty much. To be honest, yeah, not might, will.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'll tell you what then. First car you ever owned?
My first car was. I had an Audi A5 as my first car.
Well, that's quite a good first car.
It's not a bad first car. Yeah. We'd won Britain's Got Talent, wasn't yours that green Punto?
I had a P-Reg green Punto.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a proper first car. Yeah, I love that car.
Honestly, I would buy it back.
So I had a Fiat Panda.
Oh, Panda.
Nice. Yeah,
I had a little 1 litre.
Yeah, it was a 1 litre. Yeah. It was white. And it was my first car, so I loved it.
Yeah.
But I used to get a lot of road rage in that car. Because it was the
least aggressive car. Yeah,
the world's least aggressive car. Yeah, and I was really into training at the time as well. So I used to get with me in it because I was like 17 half 18 stone at the time, and lorry drivers and just every car, they're like micras. Every car on the road hates like white Fiat Pandas. So I used to like have loads and loads of lorries bibbing me and trying to force me off the road. And then like I'd sort of get out and they weren't expecting then someone to get out. It was kind of built like a brick shit
kind
house.
Of hench.
And yeah, interesting how they all kind of they're sort of testicles sack him into the body. Oh, he's bigger than I thought. Yeah, lovely, off again. So I used to quite enjoy doing that. Nice. getting up my Fiat Panda.
That's wicked.
But I've got to do a quick cue. A few quick fire things. So, scariest thing you've ever done?
Scariest thing? Honestly, I think it was doing I'm a Celeb for me. It wasn't the fact of like being scared by like the critters and the trials and all that stuff. It was being away from the group and like trying to do stuff on my own. So for me, it was I'm a Celeb. That was the scariest thing I've ever done.
Marry my wife?
Uh-oh.
Careful.
I'm telling you now. Let me give that
Literally
context.
Everyone in the room went, ooh.
No, let me give that context.
Temperature dropped about 2 degrees because everyone went,
I've never been more nervous, I'm serious, than I was on my wedding day. I don't know why. I was just really scared. Yeah, and the best and the speeches. Oh, absolutely. I was never more nervous than I was on my wedding day.
The speeches, don't talk about speeches. I had to do a best man speech, right?
That's nerve wracking, that is.
I didn't even know I had to do a speech.
Let me quickly explain this.
I had no idea
how
to do a speech.
He stood up at this table, right, on this speech. He starts talking. 30 seconds in, on cue, the lights dip. A choir walks out and starts singing as he's saying all this lovely stuff.
I didn't even have a flipping cue. The choir are my friends, and I brought them out and said, could you just start giving me some ambiance when I hit my speech? And they came out, they started singing, it was all in time, and then I sat down, and then you had to
That'd be a first for you guys.
Then I had to stand up and do a speech after his father-in-law, who basically turned into flipping Michael McIntyre. It was hilarious. I was like, what the hell's going on? But if anyone wants to know, I crushed it. It was a good speech.
Yeah, it was a good speech.
It was a good speech, I won't lie. Yeah. Don't know where it came from, but it was good.
Oh, I tell you what was a scary day, actually.
What's that?
When we did do the O2 Arena, walking out to all those people, our first big tour. That was a really scary day.
No, sorry, scarier one. Sorry, I'm going to keep listing them off. When we were driving to rehearsal for the Britain's Got Talent tour in your Punto, and your tyre blew out.
Oh, no, that was a Corsa.
That was the Corsa. His tyre blew out, doing 70 mile an hour on the motorway.
How many cars did you own?
Quite a few. My dad was a second-hand car salesman.
Oh, nice.
And we just used to nick his cars. Yeah. And that was a big
scary. So you nicked cars and he sold them? Or you just...
Oh, wow. 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 That got taken out of context quickly.
Interesting. Heard it here first. Oh, that's it. Sorry. That's it. Right.
No, we'll stop there. We'll stop there.
Okay, so who's the better dancer?
Do you know what? Ash. Let's be honest.
Oh, God, that hurt.
That was like ripping off a plaster. Ash is probably the best dancer.
He's never admitted that before.
This is when you're meant to immediately go,
it was the correct answer, but I couldn't say it.
Ash is the better dancer.
Growing up, who was the biggest crybaby?
Oh,
I'd say you.
I had a temper. I had a temper when I was a kid.
A temper, that's an understatement.
Is that you're not eating for 10 minutes?
Yeah, when I didn't get my bacon
that'll
break.
Get you. When you're angry, yeah. That
when
will
I didn't get
you.
My bacon break, I was grumpy.
Oh, do you remember when I made you chase me, saying, chase the bacon?
Yeah, in front of all of our mates, you went, chase the bacon, fat boy, holding a bag of McDonald's. And do you want to know the worst bit? I actually chased him. I really wanted that burger. I actually
but
chased
let
him.
Let me tell you why I say he's the biggest crybaby, because we used to call him Mr. Angry, because if he didn't get what he wanted, he would stand and headbutt the wall for 5 minutes when he was younger, and then cry.
Until I literally like, nearly
passed out.
He grew
out of that when he was about 20, though, didn't he, pretty much?
Yeah.
20, 25, something like that.
I love the fact you fat-shamed your brother into chasing you with a bacon sandwich, and he did it.
We were kids. I'm not proud of it. We were kids.
I did chase him as well. That's the worst part. Yeah. I actually chased him, and I got really sweaty and even fatter. It wasn't good. It wasn't good.
Fatter, but maybe it's like a cunning plan to make you lose the weight by chasing
you. He's
trying to help me out. Yeah, he's probably trying to do a solid there, but it didn't work out. Who can lift the most in the gym?
In what exercise?
Let's go classic then. Let's go squat then.
Oh, don't say squat.
You've got bad knees. Yeah, let's go bench.
Jeweled. I'll destroy him on a squat. You'll beat me on a bench, right? Yeah. What's your PB? 150 kg on a bench?
150 is my PB, which is when you consider our size and mass, there are people out there who
that's
destroy
that's a good way.
That's my 145.
Yeah,
my PB is 150. My squat PB is only 180.
We're going to drug test you later. Definitely piss test him. That's a good way,
that's
that
is. That's not bad, is it?
Cheers.
Who's the more famous?
Oh, Ash.
I don't know, Joel, mate. You're a superstar nowadays, sir.
Just we spoke about earlier consistency. You've been at it for years, bro.
I've got more time in it.
Yeah.
He's
going to
overtake me soon. Now he's going to overtake me soon.
Definitely, Ash.
Going to get serious now.
Let's go.
Now we mean business. Right, this is a think about this one.
All right,
hit me.
Biggest willy.
Oh,
that's it.
Jenny's happy to adjudicate.
She's happy to adjudicate.
I've got a story about this.
I need to know this.
So Ash, for a few years, probably again as well, did that show on ITV, the full Monty.
I was a mouse. I don't remember that.
Basically, it was actually, yeah. I was a mouse stripper for a little while.
So Ash did that show, the full Monty.
Yeah.
And me and my fiance went to watch it live, right?
And now, I had to strip naked on stage.
Ash at the end whips his hat off. You see everything. And my fiance Tony, she went, you two really do look similar. I was like, don't say it now. I was like, that's even weird. I was like, don't say it to me now. So apparently exactly the same.
Yeah, so apparently we're really similar.
Yeah, apparently exactly the same.
That's the right answer. I mean, I don't know it's the right answer.
Correct.
I'll take your word it's the right answer. Yeah. Jen can verify later.
Cheers, Jen.
Right, so this is really important one now. We ask this to everyone. You've really got to think about this as well. Right, so would you rather...
Uh-huh. Oh, good.
Like would this. You rather uh-huh. fight... A horse-sized duck,
yep.
Or 100 duck-sized horses.
100 duck-sized horses. I'm stamping for days.
You're wrong, but
I'd rather fight a horse-sized duck.
I think the one.
How are you gonna a horse-sized duck? One swipe of that wing, and you're done.
How's it go? That's the news you made earlier on TikTok.
It was.
You did.
That's it.
It went on TikTok, got 80 million views. Some people will watch any old shit, apparently. especially on TikTok. I can see we do well on TikTok now. No, I think you want that one adversary. Yeah.
But
now one-on-one.
Do you have a weapon or is it bare hands? Is it weapon or bare hands?
As in, has a duck got a weapon?
No, because that'd be hard. That'd
a
be
duck's
hard.
Got a flick knife.
That's got a flick knife.
Can a duck operate a flick knife?
In its beak, I guess.
If you've got a weapon, definitely one adversary.
Yeah, if you've got a weapon, definitely one. But if not, you can just be...
Stamp in.
How's it going?
No, ducks are quite big.
I really
big.
Hope your dancing's better than that.
Ducks not are quite big. You can't stamp on ducks.
No, he said a horse size. Oh, no, yeah. Horse, duck size. Yeah,
You're better off hoofing them.
What are we talking about?
Sorry.
It's a big question, though, isn't it?
It's a big question.
We've got all the best questions on this show, definitely. Mm. Would you rather have no sense of taste, or no, which I think we know the answer to this, no sense of taste or no sense of smell?
They're linked, aren't they?
Yeah, if you have no sense of smell, you
can... Don't look too deep into the question. Right,
No sense of smell. No sense of taste.
What about food?
You just had to do myself a favour.
I knew the answer to that because I saw the train as you rocked up in an order. No, you've got no sense of taste.
Wow. Yeah. Wow.
If you were to have a death row meal, what would it be? What would your death row meal be? I think you'd be anything.
Yeah.
Food.
Yeah, probably the other roommates, to be fair. mine's Christmas dinner.
I love Christmas dinner.
Specifically Christmas dinner. Love Christmas dinner.
Mmm. Oh, death row. Do you know what? That was really weird breath, wasn't it? Probably.
You better say something about your wife's cooking because she ain't going to be too happy after this podcast.
No, I should be fine. do you know what? I might have to go with burger and chips. I really just love a good burger.
Any particular? Yeah,
Five Guys.
Yeah, okay. Five Guys burger is nice. Is
good call.
Really is solid. It's a solid meal.
Good call.
Solid meal.
And guys, we're sort of pretty much out of time, but I could honestly talk to you guys all day long.
No, it's been good, bro.
Such good fun. I think I've just one last thing as well, because we should really have a plug for your tour next year, but connected tour next year. Yeah. When's it start? Is it pretty much sold out? Well, can we get 100 tickets anywhere? We're not bothered.
There's loads of tickets available. We're not going out next year.
It's not selling. They don't admit it. They've got a bit of a problem, basically.
This is like honesty ad libs. You know, when you actually say something, but then the subtext of what you really say. Yeah. So do you want to give the honest version of what I'm saying now?
Yeah, basically.
Here we go. I'll say what I'm going to say, give the marketing spiel, and Al will give the honesty. The tour is going quite well, but there are a few tickets still available next year.
What does that mean?
Few tickets still available.
Shit,
loads. Yeah. And we're hopefully going out in March at selected venues, because obviously we've sold out so many as it is. Honestly,
yeah. So sold. Can I have 10 front? I'm not paying for them, but can I? If I have ten, I'll buy ten front row tickets off you. If you've got any. Fine.
But yeah, we go out next March, which
depending on how much that cost.
Depending on if the theatre's still open.
Oh. Yeah, fingers crossed.
Fingers crossed. But yeah, next March, we've got like 75 dates on tour. It's going to be our biggest show yet. Super excited about
it. It was 80 a minute ago. You told me it was 80. He's just making numbers up now.
We've got five in Ireland.
I don't forget numbers. Yet. Oh, Irish don't count.
Doesn't count.
Not my words, yours. You went from 80 to 75. Was like, we've just lost five dates. Oh, that's just the Irish.
Five shows in Ireland that aren't actually out yet. I don't know if they're out at the moment, but they will be soon.
Do you have to do a different dance routine for Ireland, bear in mind they're like, sort of, because they love a bit of river dance. I love a bit of, have you got to mix it up?
The stereotypes.
Not the stereotyping, but could you, I need to see a dance off now with you guys and Michael Flatley.
We'd lose.
Michael
Flatley's an OG.
He's a legend.
Yeah, man.
I need to see that.
I'll send you a video.
We'll have to make that happen.
That's a TikTok.
That is a TikTok
waiting to happen. Guys, it's been an absolute
legend. Thank you.
Well worth the wait. That was really good. Awesome. Yeah. Thank you.
No, thanks, man.
Guys, thanks so much for listening. That was Alan Barratt with Pull the Pin. And this week we've been pulling the pin on diversity. What a couple of legends those guys are. Obviously more Ash than Jordan, but I've got to kind of say both of them as they won't talk to me again. Available now to download on all the major platforms. So tune in.